we could say we live in the worst of times and the best of times. This would be accurate. So let's look at the best of it, because the best of it is here to trump the worst of it. And the best of it is like Ramana Maharshi, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, for example. Okay, the Tibetan diaspora, okay, moving out through the world. So we have these tremendous spiritual presences that have been here in the world recently to give us a great massive boost. So why don't we benefit from this? We should be calling upon them. That's what they're here for. They know that this world is headed for a crisis. And so they're here to say, don't worry, the super positive vanquishes the super negative. And now we have this really astonishing situation here where the primal bodhisattva, certainly in Buddhism, Manjushri, who is coming into the picture here with in my case. And it's a triumvirate. I say Manjushri, Buddha, Longchenpa. Okay. Manjushri was really, some say, the records indicate, somehow he was responsible for Buddha, that drama of Buddha. And Manjushri, his name means gentle glory. Gentle glory. Longchenpa was said to be an incarnation or an appearance of Manjushri. I don't doubt that at all. The way that he expressed it is, has to come from the highest type of wisdom and clarity. It's just amazing. So we have Manjushri coming into the picture here. This is super auspicious. Now, it's Manjushri that introduced the already there perspective. Okay, already there. So we're going to talk a little bit about this. I'm just helping us all deepen our roots, get familiar with some of the bigger picture here. It's a big picture. There's a lot of troubles coming in the world, okay? But the help is so profound. It's like the sun. Today, it was very cold and chilly and foggy, and I said, oh, they said it would be a hot day. But now I just look, 10 minutes later, the fog is dispersing because the sun is so hot that it's just vaporizing the cold mist, vaporizing it, okay? So the heat of truth just vaporizes the cold, clammy mist of fear, okay? So let us not worry. In fact, let us rejoice, actually. Let us rejoice because the victory's already won. When Manjushri comes into the picture, that means the victory's already won. He has the already won perspective, which he introduced as Buddha, Shakyamuni Gautama Buddha. Buddha, this famous little, what do you call it, syllogism or analogy, something, and I've said this many times, and there's this big flooded river, and Buddha is with his arhants, his close disciples, devotees, and they said, Buddha, how do we cross this river? And they were looking, and they were seeing all these industrious people. Some were standing there in shock and saying, oh my gosh, I'm defeated. And then others were industriously trying to build little boats and little rafts. Some were trying to swim across. Some were sitting there crying, crying, crying. Some were like saying prayers to God. God, please help me. You know, this river is so tall. Please help me. And all different manners of attempts to cross that river. And then Buddha turned to his devotees, and the devotees said, hey, you know what happened? We're across already. And Buddha said, yeah, the wise, the fortunate ones, they're already on the other side. They're already on the other side. This is the already there teaching. And this comes from Manjushri. And so this has been dawning upon me now for a while. More and more and more. This is the influence of Manjushri Buddha Longchenpa. Longchenpa is called the second Buddha. May have been the second emanation of Manjushri. You can tell if it's Manjushri because it's the already there-ness is imminent. Okay, it's imminent, eminent, preeminent. Yeah. Preeminent, eminent, eminent, imminent. It's already there. It must be more than imminent, right? It's here. It's already there. This is how to practice it in the highest way. Now, there are different phases on the path, I've noticed, and we're all in one of those phases. I'm in the already there phase now. So I'm looking back in hindsight. And I see the different phases. I can see where everyone is. It's pretty easy to tell in hindsight. And there's overlapping, of course, of phases. It's worthy to note some of these phases. We go through a positive phase, and then that doesn't work, and then we go through a real negative phase. We can go through that. A lot of people are, you know, positive minded, and then at some point, you know, the troubles pile up, and they realize, hey, you know, it didn't deliver what I hoped it would. Then we can go into a nihilistic, very negative sort of phase at that point. You see that happening with people, religious people who suddenly become atheists and are very bitter. You know, they become very negative and bitter because they say, you know, all that was just a lie, you know, I can't trust anything anymore. And you go through that phase, and you go through what comes to mind is you go through a phase then where you you get some wisdom. You go through a wisdom phase, and you feel you've got some wisdom. But the siren song of this world, to be a hero, calls you, still calling you, that you're not already there, that you need to attain something. You need to get there. So you go through this effort, great effort to get there, to arrive, to attain, to triumph. And you find the stress of that then pulls you into bad habits, sex, drugs, rock and roll, so to speak. There's some decadence still there, some depravity, some perversity, all this stuff. If that starts to take hold of you, because the heroic didn't quite work, and then you go into a phase where you struggle to purify that. And then a phase can arise where you haven't really purified it enough, and you still then at some point you think, well, you've purified it enough, and now you think you can be a superhero and really get it now. And then you go into what's called a crazy wisdom phase, where you become very knowledgeable through reading and traveling and all this about esoteric stuff, the spiritual path and all this, so that you're very fluent in all that. So you can seem to be very, very wise, like a really super wise sage, but you still haven't purified yourself enough from all the bad habits. And then what happens is you go into a crazy wisdom phase where you rationalize your depravity through very clever spiritual talk, very clever spiritual talk. You've got the talk down. And so you say, no, I'm a great hero, and this is why I'm a great hero, that this other stuff is just skillful means and this. But you rationalize the depravity. This is what a crazy wisdom phase. And so that's another phase. But that's not the ultimate phase. I know they'd like to say that's the ultimate phase. It's not. You have to purify yourself more. You have to go into brahmacharya, really serious brahmacharya, in terms of just absolutely, rule out all depravity, all perversity, all degenerate activity, and be just super sober. So you have to aim for this, stone cold sobriety, just absolutely not indulging or engaging in anything which isn't just spot on. And this is the next phase beyond the crazy wisdom phase. You got to get out of that one as fast as possible, or else you get fixated in it. Fortunate are those who don't attract any followers during that phase, because if you do attract followers, that's a big problem. It feeds the psychosis, right? So what I'm getting at is always strive for purity in your life, in your actions, in your thoughts. You have to guard your thoughts very carefully. Do not let your thoughts stray. Certainly do not let them stray towards bodies and the flesh, towards any sort of fantasies of sex or violence or depravity or competition. You have to stop your, shift, be able to keep shifting off those thoughts. Now, it's not easy, of course. It's a battle and struggle. If you listen to the super gurus like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, she always emphasizes, you must purify more, you must purify more. She said, you're very pure, but you must purify more. Now, why does she say that? Okay, well, I found out the answer to this. I always said, gee, really? Yeah. So she certainly worked with me in this overall brahmacharya, super sober, super pure in terms of what we do, our actions, our thoughts, our lifestyle, all of this. You just have to be really try to be spotless. And what happens then is then you're able to get into the already there teachings, which, as far as I know, are the highest teachings. I leave the door open for something else, but it seems to be that these are the highest teachings, the already there teachings, that Manjushri Long Buddha Longchenpa specialize in. Now, Buddha understood this, that so he laid out a path of how do we purify ourselves. So, the Four Noble Truths, we have that, the Three Jewels of Four Noble Truths, the Eightfold Path of this. He understood that you go through these phases and you have to ultimately get to the already there phase teachings. But you won't be able to do that as long as you have these, call them samskaras, these karmas, these negativities, these tendencies. So you have to really work on that. Now, so This is essential. I know Dzogchen says, no gradualist path, but the Dzogchen is the already there teaching. So it's only for the fortunate few, actually, who have already been able to, fight their way through to that purity. And you'll find it in your life, like the way you eat and just the music you listen to or don't listen to, the books you read or don't read, the programs you pay attention to or don't pay attention, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And you find yourself breaking these long-held habits. This is what I had to do. And maybe, very difficult ones. For instance, baseball. I've had a lifelong addiction when I was 6 years old. I started following baseball. And I just became a complete addict to it and have been so my whole life. I always watched the games, always listened to the games, always paid attention to all the statistics, everything that was going on. And it just consumed my life, is like a pastime. It was my pastime. It helped me focus on something, that wasn't so terrible in my life. I enjoyed the unpredictability of it, and there was a lot mentally to enjoy about it. But this last year, August of last year, I realized it was time to boycott baseball, and I have. I have not watched any game for over a year, or listened to any game for over a year, or read the news for over a year. This was an extreme addiction I had. So I've dropped sports. I've dropped all sports. I've dropped all, which has been my lifelong passion, following sports, basketball, all sports. I dropped all sports. How about that for an enormous effort? Okay, this is the kind of effort. Boycott the news. I haven't paid any attention to the news. Little stuff filters through from friends, and if you're on Facebook, there might something pops up, or your cursor goes over something. But I mean, I haven't turned on the television for more than a year. No television, no news, no sports. So these are three extreme addictions. I mean, if you talk about, when we're talking about purity, I mean, there's nothing that seems to harm our purity more than watching the news. Okay, watching the news. Reading magazines. I don't read any magazines. Okay. Popular culture is extremely perverse. Okay. Poisonously perverse popular culture. And so you have to, if you want to reach the already there teachings, you have to get away from that. There's no two ways about it. So I can testify to this. The benefits of boycotting the world, as I call it, which is really essentially what we need to do. You wonder why these mystics, they go into this boycott the world mentality. Longchenpa lives in a cave. He says, stay away from this, stay away from that. The benefit is you get to the already there teachings. You're able to resonate with them. Okay, now. So that this is the you could probably the highest phase you can get to is the already there teachings. From this standpoint, where you go is into abundance. Okay, so let's clarify this. Prior to this phase, what I had was glimpses of reality, glimpses of truth. It's like astonishing. Oh my gosh, this is great. I'm almost there. This is wonderful. But then I found that I couldn't remain in this awareness. I had some very, very profound experiences that Jesus tells us about, vision of oneness. And, we're all one spiritual family. No one has ever fallen from grace. God, no one is forsaken. There's nothing wrong with any one of us. We're all still perfect as we always have been. These experiences, intrinsic spaciousness, all these great experiences that we're told about are possible. I've had these experiences, but I couldn't remain with them. I got freaked out a little bit. How do I integrate that? What do I do with this? So it's very frustrating, very frustrating, very frustrating. So I said, okay, I've got to, this is just all important. I have to abide in this. I, I, There's nothing else left for me to do. These glimpses are too stressful to than to lose it. It's too stressful for me. I've you know, so this is then where I had to make extra efforts to start pushing away this other stuff, pushing away the news, pushing away the politics, pushing away social issues, pushing away, entertainment, pushing away music, pushing away, food habits have changed. I under eat. I don't eat very much. I mostly just drink smoothies, and I don't think about meals really so much. Meals, I don't really think. I just, if I want, I'll have a few swigs of a smoothie, and then that's it for a while. And then later on, maybe I have a few more. I make a smoothie in the morning, and I kind of push it all through the day. If it gets low, I dilute it with add some stuff, and then sort of keep it going. This is what I do. I don't think about like dinner, breakfast, lunch so much. So much more fruit. Certainly, no meat, cut down on the spices and the meat, and no meat. I'm a vegetarian. I've been so for a long, most of my life. So you start really being scrupulous. And the goal is abidance. Goal is abidance. So I've been working on this goal of abidance now for maybe about 3 years. So ever since I met Longchenpa and had this experience of intrinsic spaciousness, and I said, "Oh, that's it. There's no question about it." I said, "This is what they're talking about. Wow, it's so obvious. It's completely obvious. How could I have not seen this my whole life? That is astonishing. It's astonishing. It's so completely obvious. Nothing ever leaves intrinsic spaciousness. Nothing's ever moving in relation to intrinsic spaciousness at all. There's no movement in relation to intrinsic spaciousness at all. This is vision of nirvana, you might say. So you have to put on this extra push to get now to this already there teaching. Now, I've had Longchenpa, Jamyang Kyentse, Choki Lodro, and Manjushri. They've been really very accommodating and boosterish of me and saying, "Hey, we need you. Not just we like you. We really want you. We really need you. We really need you." That kind of attitude is very helpful. It's not more than just we want you. We need you. They're very adamant and boosterish. So these are the phases that we go through. And you're likely to, touch on all these phases. We go through these things, we touch upon the key is to get the help of the super gurus, the Dharma kings. And they have these skillful means to get you into the already there practice. Now, it wasn't easy to say the least. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma helped me out a lot. It helped me go get through the crazy wisdom phase without too much trouble. You really need the Dharma kings, the super gurus, to help you through that crazy wisdom thing. Otherwise, you run the risk of getting snared, hooked by that. You end up saying, "Well, everybody's got some depravity. There's no way to get around it, so we might as well just, celebrate it." And therefore, we misinterpret the Dzogchen teachings in a crazy wisdom way. That's actually a misinterpretation. It really is. Longchenpa made very, very clear that he doesn't put up with that kind of nonsense. He's admonished the crazy wisdom folks, very much so. that's what happens. Now, I didn't come across Dzogchen until I was already past the crazy wisdom phase. So I just took to it like a duck takes to water. I just got it straight immediately, what was being referred to. I said, oh, yeah, that's it. So that's a great advantage that I had, which is why the samaya around Dzogchen is important. It's when you come across it that's important. And I was introduced to it directly by Longchenpa himself. I wasn't aware of it previous to that. So I had the experience first of intrinsic spaciousness. Then I came across spaciousness, that. So, I did some attempts to share it with the world, but maybe, I don't know if that was right or not. It's an experience. Not many picked up on it, which is okay. It's there for those who have the experience of intrinsic spaciousness. So I had that first, and then I became aware of Dzogchen. But then I knew what it was really referring to. But prior to that, I worked with Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma for quite some time, almost a decade of evaporating the attraction to crazy wisdom. Here in the West, that's a great temptation for us. In the world in general, because the world is so depraved right now, that people tend to try and celebrate their depravity. They really do. And so you think, oh, okay, well, this is what we're supposed to do. You can't really get free of that. That's part of our human nature, we say. You know, this is just part of life. Okay. No, not true at all. Not true at all. But the temptation here is enormous. So you try to integrate that with spiritual truth as you understand it, then you end up with this, okay, crazy wisdom teaching, crazy wisdom guru, you know, this. You end up like that, and that's not it. Fortunately, we had some great examples of that in the West, which was actually super helpful for us. You know, it was such a problem that a lot of us were not pleased about it at all. But in hindsight, you know, if you make it through, then you realize it was actually very helpful because they showcase for us what not to do and how that turns out and left a, you know, bitter taste in our mouth, to be sure. We had some examples here in the world and in the West of that, how the wheels come off of that. And yeah, it's very disappointing for us. It's very demoralizing. It's kind of like, wow, we really can't make it. If that's the highest there is. You know, we were told that this is the highest. Crazy wisdom is the highest. They tend to say that. Rationalization, of course. They say, well, nothing I can do about it. This is the highest, and so, you know, let's just make the most of it. Make the most of our depravity. If that's the highest, then, you know, what hope is there for us? We might as well. So it causes you to sink back down. It can really cause a culture to sink back down. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma came on the scene and began helping me. She's been overshadowing my life, overshadows many of our lives in the background. She jumped into the foreground as I was about to really succumb to all this. And then she began sending me on all these wild goose chases, which was amazing. I went through this whole sadhana, Lila of Sadhana, with her. And gradually, I was able to get free of all that. But that was very difficult, to say the least, because of the bad examples we've had. But again, in hindsight, it was a shock treatment. You say, oh my gosh, somehow I've got to be, you know, better than these, you know, crazy wisdom gurus who claim that they're the greatest. You know, this is it. Very daunting task, but very doable. With that grace of the Dharma Kings, very doable. They're beyond that, and they know how to get beyond that. So we're putting all that in our rearview mirror, have been. And we just thank them, you know, and bless them for, you know, showcasing just how bad that really is, how that isn't it. And this has called for, you know, this has forced us to dig deeper and make contact with the real top gurus, the real McCoys, and ultimately get to the already there teachings of Manjushri, Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, the real core truth, the highest truth. So this is starting to percolate now. On Facebook, I put out a lot of this already there, quote, comments. I comment myself, quote, some of the teachers. This is, and people are picking up on this. They're saying, hey, so it is, Ram Maharshi is a great already there teacher also. All the Dharma kings are. Beautiful. The teaching of Ramana is now starting to be felt, you know, I have to he's coming alive more and more, realizing, oh wow, what a super, super teacher we have there. And the gurus, non-dual gurus, etc., there's a flavor to it there. We're picking up on that. So actually, we're in a very auspicious time right now. So we don't have to look at the negativity of the world at this point. It's not necessary, because we are in such an auspicious time right now for us that this is what has our attention. You see, when we feel the auspiciousness, we don't worry about the cold mist. You know, we realize that now that I look up, it's gorgeous blue sky right now. Wow. When I came out first, it looked like a chilly, cold, terrible day. Now it's just splendid, beautiful, beautiful day. So we're in this most auspicious time right now. And I should have mentioned, I mentioned Ram Maharshi, Sri Sri Nanamayama, you could say Jamyang Kenzi Chokilodo, the Tibetan diaspora, etc. But there's one other extremely auspicious occurrence that we've had in our times here, which is Jesus Christ and A Course in Miracles, and Brent Haskell and Journey Beyond Words and the Other Voice, which is a companion to A Course in Miracles. This is from Jesus Christ. And this helps get us up to speed to the already there teachings in a fabulous way. And I'm sure that those of the East are scratching their heads a little bit. I'm coming across this. They're saying, like, because rightfully so, they have a great pride in their spiritual heritage. You know, they can be really focused and very advanced in Eastern disciples, India and Tibet, etc., and other places throughout the world, China, the whole Eastern thing. And us Westerners look like country bumpkins, you know, hillbilly, redneck hillbillies, spiritual hillbillies, right? And they're a little, you know, condescending and such, but not in a bad way, but just, you know, it's just they feel like, you know, we're spiritual hillbillies, and in a lot of ways you could say this is so. So it must come as quite a surprise and shock to them to see someone who's comfortable, familiar, and somewhat fluent in already there-ness teachings. They're kind of like, wow, what? How did this happen? How could this happen? And the answer is, A Course in Miracles is how it happened. And honestly, most people aren't aware of A Course in Miracles throughout the world. It was just for Jesus says, for the teachers of God. It was a fast track way to get to the already there teachings. So 40 years of immersion in A Course in Miracles and getting on the fast track can do wonders, can do wonders. And I'm finding that those who have a background in A Course in Miracles are able to shift into this already there perspective rather easily, actually, rather easily. So Jesus has done a fabulous job. But it wasn't easy. I mean, but part of the problem of like feeling like you're second class citizen, you're the second son, you're a spiritual hillbilly, and you feel like you're behind everyone else. You feel like you're and so it causes you to be driven. You don't rest on your laurels because you don't have any. So I said, "Wow, I'm so far behind all these Tibetans and all the East." I said, "Wow, I just gotta put my nose to the grindstone because I don't want to, it's embarrassing, shameful, So it's a sense of shame, like I'm so, illiterate compared to them. What's going on?" And so, you try harder. You try, it's 16 hours a day. And sometimes it was 24 hours a day for me. And I would just go until I just absolutely, couldn't take another step but just collapse into bed. And then I get the next day and do the same thing. I did it every single day and I still do. I'd, read A Course in Miracles all day long from the moment I got up until the moment I went to bed. It was 16 hours, 18 hours, 20 hours, and did every single day, year after year after year after year after year, decade after decade. So it's just it's like I felt so intimidated by the crazy wisdom teachers and all the Eastern stuff and all this stuff, and felt so handicapped by the Western ideologies and materialism that I just felt desperate, desperate. And so this desperation and extreme determination, steady extreme determination, enables us to break through all this ice like an icebreaker. Breakthrough, breakthrough, just keep breaking breakthroughs, constantly, breakthrough, breakthrough. So that's, my life's been nothing but breakthroughs, just constantly breaking through the ice. And the upshot is that Longchenpa said, "Hey, I like this. I like this. There's momentum here. Welcome to intrinsic spaciousness and the already there teachings." And so for me, nothing changed because I still every day I'm completely driven. So I was able to just say, well, I mean, whatever breakthroughs I have, it doesn't change my work ethic, you see. I'm just so accustomed to every day it's all out. Today is, I have to make the greatest effort I've ever made in my life today. Like yesterday, I did that. I did this video. It's called Entrance of Grace, and it's the best video I've ever made. This is what I feel because I put the whole day, I put the whole production in the hands of Manjushri, the already there-ness, and I said, it's your video. I'll just, punch the buttons, okay? And it's just a profound video. I was so rocked by it myself. I know it's a tough audience here in the world, isn't it? If it doesn't have blood, then they're not interested. It's got to have sex and violence and drama and blood and everything and depravity. If it doesn't have that, they're not interested. Well, it doesn't have it. It doesn't have any of that. But for me, watching the video, just editing it and going through it and going through it and going through it, Yeah, it just knocked me out. I just said, wow. You just don't see a video like this. You just don't see entertainment like this. You just don't see it. It's very unique. And it's surreal in a super positive way. It's unconventional in a non-depraved way. It's going back to that the child who's not depraved and not perverse and all this stuff, and just being fresh and clean with no caffeine. No caffeine. I boycott caffeine. Absolutely. It's very difficult in today's society to not have any take any caffeine under any circumstances, but that's what I do. So these disciplines are very difficult, but I do them. I'm successful at them, but it takes a battle of will and determination. You have to call, there's been several times I felt I have to drink caffeine or I'm going to crash my vehicle. And then I call upon Jamyang Khyentse Choekyi Lodro. He seems to be very helpful in certain ways. And I said, you got to help me because this is going to cause me to backslide. I'm going to fail to reach my objective you have for me. And somehow the capacity arrived somehow, and I didn't take any caffeine, and I didn't lose any momentum. It is extraordinary, extraordinary. So, for many, caffeine is the most difficult. Really, I understand that entirely. And without confidence in the Dharma Kings, you probably won't be able to do it, because it's the most dangerous. Drugs are so dangerous. You can't get to this already there-ness by with using drugs. And the crazy wisdom, quote unquote, adept at what, really? They use drugs. Okay. And they say, no, that's just all part, And they spin off some Dzogchen, to justify it or whatever, right? You cannot get to the already there clarity and use drugs at the same time. It's not possible. It's not possible. This is why Sri Sri Nandamayi was very strict with her close devotees, exceedingly strict, and says, you got to keep breaking those bad habits. And, this one, there's another one. She kept pointing out, you still have this one, this one, this one. Break that one, that one. And this is how she's been with me, this inner grace of, well, what about this habit? I say, oh my God, yeah, you're right. But that one, oh, I need sometimes. Just really, So she's just worked with me to get rid, to get past these bad habits. And you have to be very strict with yourself. You have to be very strict. You cannot make exceptions. You cannot make exceptions. I almost made an exception last night. I said, oh, okay, well, I've succeeded in not following baseball, so the season's almost over, so why don't I just check the standings, see how the Giants are doing? And I said, no, what am I talking about? Let me finish the whole season off by not watching, the Giants. Why not succeed completely? Don't stumble at the finish line. And so I didn't do it. I said, so the temptations keep arising, and you will find this, and they'll torment you, and you have to use your will to say, no, not right now, not yet, not tonight. I'm not going to stumble. I have too many things I've got to accomplish that are important here. I can't afford to fall back in this way. I can't afford to fall back. And then, so you get stuff done. Now, you might say, well, how did I get that video done in one afternoon, one evening? I actually used a clip from the evening before. Let's say I got it done in one day, but it was really less than that, like half a day. I got the whole video done in half a day. And this may, shock people. And I had no idea what to do with the video. The grace of God indicated to me where to go, where to focus on, and ultimately, it all just happened the way it was supposed to happen, You know, first time I've ever did any vocalizing on a video. And I just started doing it. And somehow I was able to do it. Normally I don't sing out in public like that. I'm inhibited. And even on the vocalizing I did here, I was inhibited. I was one step down from just actually letting it go. Letting it go. Which I can do, like in your vehicle, if you turn up a music loud, you can sing along with it, and you know nobody can hear you, so you become uninhibited, and then it flows, and you can sing great. But when you're like out in public place, like I was walking along out in public, you think, well, someone might hear me, I don't want to sing too loud, someone might hear me. And so it inhibits, so I didn't really vocalize the way I'm capable of. It was like a couple steps down, and then a couple times I did pretty well, but you know, it's not what I can really do. But it was pretty good. First time I've ever done that. And so I heard it, it came out fine. It's just, there's no reverb, there's no effects, nothing on it. That's just straight. Everything's just straight. Completely clean. All spontaneous. Now, what's the benefit of these videos? The benefit is that it starts giving you, well, it's whatever it is for you, actually. It's whatever it is. I can't define. Everyone will take it differently. But keep in mind that at least this video, I'm inviting Manjushri in to take charge of the videos. So for me, it's intriguing because this is like so different, actually. The whole thing, the spontaneity of it, the unplannedness, spontaneity, and yet there's some editing skills. I did a lot of editing work on it. I was able to, you know, it's not easy on YouTube. I did it all on YouTube. So I didn't use any software. I just did it on YouTube. It's very frustrating to do it on YouTube. Very frustrating. Every time you put in a transition, it immediately loops back to the start of the video and starts again. So hundreds of times it went back to the start. So it takes, you know, great patience to do this, and just a lot of know-how, actually, to do it fast like this. Just fast, clean, and yet a little ragged. It's the antithesis of our modern world, where something like this, someone would, you know, spend like months on it to tweak this. Productions take months. Even small ones, and you know, every little detail, they're trying to put the icing on a cake, you know, but the entertainment industry is like, they're always trying to put icing on the cake, but the cake is just this rotting pus, you know, cheesecake made of pus, you know, and they try to dress it up in all this beautiful icing, and that's all, it's all icing. There's no substance to it at all, actually. There's none. There's no real substance to modern entertainment, popular culture entertainment. There's zero. It's all icing. And some try to celebrate no substance. You know, like, yeah, we're completely depraved. Isn't that awesome? You know, no, it's not awesome. So here, it's the cake. And then I put a little icing on it, too. Okay. So I'm kind of, but it's done quickly, because we're in a hurry. We don't have time. I don't have time to spend a month on, or a week on some production. I mean, when I do something, it has to be done today. So my focus is, this video is being filmed and made available today. So it was available the same day. The whole thing was done like that. We don't have time for anything, any procrastination at all. What are these? The world is lacks a sense of urgency. As the great Dharma kings say, your house is burning down. What are you doing? Saying, well, someday I'll get to this. Now, to do a video that fast, you have to be humble enough to realize it's going to be ragged, and people will say, well, it could have been better. Why didn't you spend more time on this? And so you always have this feeling, wow. You have to forego the polish. You have to forego the accolades that people will give to you if it's super polished. So it's very demanding of humility. No actors, no nothing, all spontaneous, just done, boom, 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 boom. And you have to trust it, that it's good. And I do, I trust it. The message there, the overall feel is profound, and however you take it, it's what you put into it. You get out of it what you put into it. And it invites putting something into it. Put something into it. Don't just be this, we're so used to now to just be sit there, zombies watching entertainment on television. We don't put anything into it. Here, you've got to put something into it. Maybe watch it twice, maybe three times. Go back to it. And each time, put something and feel something. Feel something profound. The whole idea here is everything we do is to feel the profundity. Feel the shock of profundity. Feel the shock of profundity and then just let it settle. Let it settle. This is the discipline that gets us past this crazy wisdom stuff in the world, which we must not get caught up in that now. We must. At all costs, you see, I say at all costs. I get a lot of backlash here in your personal life. You may get a lot of backlash and grumpiness and stuff. It's not easy because people say, "Well, what are you doing? What's your urgency? What is this?" But I know the urgency. Okay, at all costs, we must get past this crazy wisdom, folly, really phase. We must get past it now. Otherwise, we'll get sucked into a black hole. So the way to do this is to experience profundity, and you'll be shocked by it. And you say, "Oh my gosh, I'm doing it." And then you must full stop in the wow of the shock. You practice, and then at some point, the shock of success dislodges your attention from your practice. And at that point, or just prior to it, you can feel it coming. So I'm able to feel it coming and then take a proactive move and say, I'm going to go into full stop on the wow right now before the shock, full shock hits me. But this comes with practice. You become expertly proactive. Initially, the shock will hit you, then you go into the wow. For me, now I anticipate it. I can feel it coming. And then I just go into the west, okay, and then it really smooths out your path, really smooths it out. With drugs, you can't evaluate properly. This is a trouble. So you can't do this practice while on drugs. It's not possible, really. You won't get it. You won't get better at it. And getting better at it means you're able to proactively anticipate the wow. You see it coming, you feel it coming, and instead of waiting for it to hit you real hard, you start the full stop on the wow right now. And then this gives you great confidence to go have even greater breakthroughs because you won't allow, the severe backlash to hit you. You'll already be in full stop in the way. I'm already there. Already there. But you can't develop this expertise if you're using drugs on the path. You cannot. You'll stall out here. Same thing if you're a sex addict, you'll see, oh, I can always turn to that. I don't need to do the wow. I'll medicate it that way, so to speak. But here, we don't do anything about the wow. We just let it settle naturally with patience. We don't try to treat the wow. You don't try to ground it. Like people will say, oh, let's treat it somehow. The profundity, let's ground it in the flesh. Something that we, let's put it into this context of sex, for instance. Let's put it into that context. That's a huge mistake. So you really need to be celibate, brahmacharya, off all drugs, all the stuff, to practice and chaste in your mind. You must have a chaste mind. You must purify your mind so it's very chaste, so it doesn't go think start thinking in the direction of the flesh at all. And so then all you do is you just sit in the wow and just let it settle naturally. It's all you do. There's no other option. There are no answers to it. You just let it settle. There are no thoughts about, well, what do I do about this? How can I treat this? You don't treat it. You treat it with patience, attention, discipline. Have extreme chastity in all directions. And then you can allow the already there breakthroughs to dawn upon you, and you just wow it. That's all you do. Now, age has its benefits here. When you're older, it's you have an advantage in various ways. Chastity is easier. Your habits, also the urgency, you realize you're running out of days in your life, and so you become very urgent, very focused every single day, every moment of every day, all of this stuff, you don't have any more time to waste. So oftentimes you can get to this already there in your later years. So I've moved into it in my late 50s, and now in starting the 60s, I'm very much into it. So if you're younger than this, you had better realize this opportunity is there for you. Okay, so this is very helpful, I believe, for everyone, especially the younger, those of us who are in younger phase. If you really apply yourself when you're younger and break all as many bad habits as you can and work in this direction and just don't give up, when you reach late 50s, 60s, let's say, you'll be right there, just go right into it. And you may very well reach guru vision this life, you see? So don't despair. Don't despair. 60 is not a death sentence. So if the problem of the younger people of today is they view older people as like we're all idiots. We're all unsuccessful idiots. We've wasted our lives. Well, that's true in most cases. But the exception here shows that it's not a rule at all, actually. It's not a rule at all. It just means that they let their bad habits, they didn't apply enough steady determination in their lives. This is plain and simple. What steady determination is indispensable. It's a prerequisite cannot do it without steady determination. But the question is, well, how do you get steady determination? And the answer is you must be aware of continuity fear and full stop in the wow practice. You have to become aware of continuity fear to make your determination steady. Otherwise, it'll be too ragged. It'll be very ragged. It won't be steady. So I became aware of continuity fear, and it dawned upon me, oh, this is what's making my past so ragged, spiky up and down. It's so as soon as I began then to really become aware of that, I began to smooth the path out more and keep the determination much more steady. And it was just, you have to be patient and realize it's a sign of success. So how can we be so patient? It's by recognizing the backlash you get is actually the shock of the success that you're having. So you don't get frustrated with yourself. You don't get despair. You don't fall into despair anymore. You say, "Well, this is great. Wow, this is great." So instead of saying, "Oh, I stalled out," no, say, "Wow, this is great." You completely flip the script. Completely flip the script. Wow, this is great. Wow, this is great. I'm experiencing the wow. The shock of continuity fear. I'm experiencing the wow of this. So in your mind, you just flip it from a negative to a positive, just like that. And as soon as you do that, that liberates your attention. And you feel in charge of your life once again and confident once again. And then this enables you then to start more practice soon. It's the most amazing dynamic I've ever come across, is to recognize the continuity fear, the wow of success, how this can transform depression, despair, instantly into confidence. I just did it right now. I mean, it's the greatest miracle there is, this discovery. So I'm feeling like tired, just worried out. I say, how can I do this? I've stalled out. I'm this or this. And I say, hey, wait a minute. No, you're just completely blitzed by amazing success, amazing progress, great breakthroughs, stunning. And you're just temporarily shocked and stunned by this, how great it's going for you. And I say, yeah, that's true. Wow, this is great that I feel this way. It's wonderful that I'm feeling this way. And suddenly optimism and confidence is just bubbling up in me. And I guarantee this is true for everyone. There's any depression, any despair, any state of mind we're in can be very quickly transformed into this confidence and feeling of competency and assurance. And like, I got this. And suddenly, from being on bottom, the world on top of you, suddenly you're on top of the world. Just like that. Just like that. And this is the holy grail of spiritual practice, actually. It's the holy grail. So we have the holy grail here. We are drinking from the holy grail, actually, here. What's the blood of Christ? Wisdom and skillful means on the path is the blood of Christ. So if we're bringing the blood of Christ from the Holy Grail, it's this wisdom of practicing, knowing how to flip the script on despair and depression. That's the blood of Christ, actually. That's the body and blood of Christ. He made it very clear he was referring to his teachings. And the wisdom of his teachings. That's what he was referring to. He was not referring to his, he said, the body profiteth absolutely nothing. He's speaking of his own body too. He wasn't making an exception. So he was very clear that the Eucharist symbolizes skillful means in practicing body and the blood of Christ, drinking from the Holy Grail. And we are doing that right now. This is the body and the blood of Christ, is this full stop on the wow, recognizing continuity fear, the wow, and seeing it as meaning you're really, really getting it done. You're doing a great job. And you tell yourself this, I'm doing a fabulous job. I'm doing great. That's why I feel so down. Is the shock of success, you know, it is just temporarily stunning me. I'm in a state of positive shock. So positive shock can make us feel real tired and down, just the same as negative shock. Shock is shock, basically, right? But when you recognize it's not because something bad happened, it's because something great happened, that this you're flooded with this confidence. But if you don't do that, you go downhill. So we have discovered the Holy Grail here. We have it. We have the true Eucharist of Christianity here. You could say this is the true church, the true teachings of the church right here. You could say all of that, and it would be true. It would be true. But don't think that Buddhism doesn't have these same skillful means as well. Yeah, I mean, it's the same. These are the skillful means, and so you have to discover this. Manjushri certainly knows. Buddhism certainly knows. Longchenpa certainly knows. Along with Jesus and the Dharma kings, they all know this. Ramaharshi, the steady determination, he knows this. They all know the same. Okay, it's nothing special to Christianity at all. Okay, nothing special. Religions don't have anything special. It's the same, it's the same, it's the same. Taking the Eucharist every day is a way of saying on the path, you need to stun yourself with success every day and have the patience to let this settle down. So you take the Eucharist and you flip the script into the full stop in the wow, and then you let it settle down. So after taking the Eucharist, actually you're supposed to sit quietly for longer. I mean, the Mass, they don't do it properly. It's just a skeleton, really. They don't really understand it the way it's supposed to be understood anymore. You're supposed to be quiet for, I would give it 20 minutes, okay, at least. But instead, after everybody's taken the Eucharist, you know, the priest sits down for a couple minutes, and then he says, okay, and we'll do a closing prayer, and then notices of the next week and the next day, and then they go into the band kicks up, and they do this real peppy song. Everyone's clapping and, you know, clapping and singing, and everyone walks out in a happy mood, chatting this and visiting. This is entirely wrong. This is entirely wrong. Because they think it's a magical thing. They've misconstrued it as literal body and blood, flesh. This is not true. This is the Old Testament way. So they've gone back to Old Testament ways, worshiping the golden calf of Old Testament ways. It's not being done in the way Jesus wants it, New Testament way at all. So by drinking the body and the blood of Christ, it means you are having faith in success on the spiritual path. And so you flip the script of the homily and the previous readings and everything that wow, you know, you get it, this profound teaching. Then you're shocked, you take the Eucharist, and then this is having faith in Jesus Christ that we will succeed, and we are succeeding. And then this helps you go into the wow, like I am succeeding. This is why I feel kind of down right at this moment. It's the shock of success. And then you're supposed to sit and let this wow settle down. very quiet, not taking any steps other than just patience and just abiding in that patience. This is the true Mass. This is how it really goes. We're doing true Mass here, actually. This is the true Christian Mass that we do in these videos, actually. So without doing anything at all, just let it settle down. Like water stirred up, there's mud in the water. If you keep trying to do something, you just stir it up more. You just have to be patient, let it settle, and it will settle. Meanwhile, you're full of this new hope and feeling, you know, I've got this. I'm confident. I'm really succeeding. I really am going to succeed. I'm on top of the world, actually. I'm really on top of the world. I'm going so fast, I got a little scared there for a while. So it's a sign I'm just going so fast, I got a little nervous. So I'll coast for a while. So you're just coasting for a while, having faith in Jesus, that coasting is okay, because He's going to bring us all the way. Meaning His example is assurance for us, right? This is all the Dharma kings, their example is assurance for us. So, it's a shock right now of we've discovered the Holy Grail, that we had it. And we now know the true Eucharistic celebration, what the body and blood of Christ really means. Yes, wisdom and skillful means. The right practices that He's given, that He gave out, that the Holy Spirit gives out. And now, perfect example. We don't try to explain this too much anymore, because we're in the wow of this. So we drop explanations. We get out of the explaining part of our mind. It's very important to be able to shift back and forth between the explaining part of our mind and the part that doesn't need to explain. Nothing wrong with flipping the script and explaining, but then when it's time, shift out of it. Into the already answered part. It's already answered. All explanations have already been... Everything's already been clarified. So I'm already in that now. The confidence of that. So Christian mysticism has understood it to a greater degree than just the ordinary Christianity right now, as you go to church and, you know, once a week or whatever. It's not really being presented. It's being presented the way that those who go to church probably want it to be presented at this, you know, right? But where does that leave the rest of us? Very, very interesting, very powerful. The Eucharist is something concrete, right? And what you're doing is you're saying, okay, now I'm going to full stop on the wow of just concreteness. I'm not going to pursue abstraction nor embrace concreteness, but I'm going to be patient and let it all settle, which seems to be, you know, you're dropping the abstraction momentarily for a while. So that Eucharist then is a way of breaking your meditation into the wow, full stop in the wow. That Jesus advises us to accept now that you will feel a little more concrete, but interpret it in a positive way instead of a despairing way. Take some substance of the world, worldly substance, but interpret it in the right way. That, yeah, I'm going to go forward now with my life after this Mass, but I'm going forward with confidence in success, that I will succeed in Guru Vision, that I am succeeding. So after your focus here, right, we're going back to the world. So it's a kind of way of going back to the world, but in the right way, the Eucharist, going back in the right way. That, yes, I have drunk from the cup of the Holy Grail, which is right spiritual practice. And this will help sanctify me as I go forward in the world, because I have the confidence now that I am succeeding. And despair is not guiding me. I'm wow, the wow. I can use the wow and it works. I use the wow and it works. I don't need despair to guide me. The whole purpose of existence is despair. Okay, so we have to be very keen on this issue of the wowness and not despair. It's the antidote to despair. And we have to be cognizant of this every day, all day, because despair is always, you know, nipping at our heels, saying, hey, come back to despair. That's how you'll succeed. Because, again, the whole purpose of existence, which is really just a dream, it's a projection of our spiritual imagination. The design, what we're projecting, is designed for despair, to give us this perspective of despair. And we believe that this will then change, modify what we are. And in being able to modify what we are, this means that we're separate from God. That we're separate from God. Because being one with God, we cannot modify what we are. We're an idea in the mind of God. So to modify what we are would be modifying the mind of God, which is not possible. So, but we're trying to do that. We're trying to modify the mind of God by modifying what we are, and then claim that we're separate from God. We're our own. We created ourselves. We're our own God. This is our arrogance that is responsible for this existence, the domain of energy, actually. The main of energy is simply the projection of spirit's imagination in an attempt to modify what it is. So the universe of energy, electromagnetic energy, that's what it is. It's a dream. And nature and everything that arises with electromagnetic energy, it's all a dream. In various energies, whatever you want to call energy. Reality is not energy, actually. So this dream is designed for despair. It's designed to create spiritual despair. So we feel this despair creeping up on us. But instead, we flip it and say, wow, this is just continuity fear, is all it is. So I don't have a despair problem. I have a continuity fear problem. This is very important to say this. I do not have a despair problem. I have a continuity problem. Fear problem. The continuity fear problem is the only problem I have. Therefore, the despair problem doesn't exist for me. Does not exist. And the vision of oneness is the remedy for continuity fear, a continuity problem. Vision of oneness, vision of Christ, vision of sameness, guru vision is the remedy, is the only cure there is for continuity fear. So I have one problem and one cure for that problem. Very simple. Yes, it's a very severe problem. So I do not have a despair problem. I do not have a despair problem. I have a continuity fear problem. And it's the only problem I have. Yes, it's a very severe problem, but it's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problems whatsoever. And guru vision is the remedy for the one problem that I have. It's the only remedy there is. It's the only remedy there is. So we can practice in this way. I do not have a despair problem. I have a continuity fear problem. Continuity fear problem is the only problem I have, and yes, it's very severe, but there's a remedy for it, which is guru vision, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. And that's the only remedy there is. I have only one problem and only one remedy for it. So say this again and again and again. I have only one problem and there's only one remedy for it. That's it. That's why Jesus said there's one way. There's just one remedy, in other words, for the problem. He's speaking of the guru vision, vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I am that. I am that meaning I identify as intrinsic spaciousness. I am the way identifies as intrinsic spaciousness. So Jesus was speaking from the standpoint of intrinsic spaciousness, from the standpoint of guru vision. When he says I, he doesn't mean the body, the personality, all that. No, he means I, the intrinsic spaciousness, true identity. I am the way. There's only one way. That's the remedy for continuity fear, is we perceive this, the emphasis upon non-modification. So we perceive, feel intrinsic spaciousness. It's a kind of perceived feeling of intrinsic spaciousness, of non-modification. Nothing's modifying intrinsic spaciousness at all. And abide in this. This is guru vision. And this is the way. This then evaporates all remaining continuity fear. In Dzogchen, they have this phase of, what was it, in Tibetan Buddhism, some term, Ngondro or something, Ngondro, that may be a little bit off, but it's all the basic stuff of purification, accumulating merit. It really means purification of your life. So, Christianity has this too. It's the church, and the church is supposed to lead them to mysticism and monastic discipline and like that. It's a phase you go through to purify your habits and stuff. So they use the Virgin Mary to help out with that, which is fine. It's the archetype of purity, chastity, purity. That's very important. But that's not the Holy Grail. You know, they've got it. As it spun back towards despair, then they tried to make that the Virgin Mary the end-all and be-all. No, the having good habits, is super important. But this then ultimately leads through these various phases to the already-there-ness, to then guru vision of intrinsic spaciousness, which is what Jesus is represents and was speaking from. So it's not just our behaviors that's an end. The means are not an end in themselves. So the Catholicism, for instance, kind of has it right in the structure, some of the structures, but it's not playing out now properly, maybe because of the people in the world right now. Their mindset is not capable of recognizing it. They have Mary, like a chapel for Mary, okay. That's fine. This represents, in the Eastern teachings, it would represent Vajrayogini, Vajravarahi, okay. The Queen of the Dakinis, Queen of Heaven. This represents the skillful means of purifying your habits. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma represents that, Vajrayogini, Vajravarahi. You could say Kali, you know, you could say all these various things, Queen of Heaven, Queen of Dakinis. This is an aspect of grace that helps us with our worldly habits. So the Virgin Mary, Catholicism used her in this way, sort of, some of the time. Now the Spanish used her as a warrior goddess, to conquista, you know, conquista, for the conquista. That's not the right way to use the Virgin Mary. That's the wrong way. So it's gotten, you know, it depends who's looking at it, right? As you play the piano, so you hear the music. So for the countries that were, you know, under conquest by the Spanish, they have a different view of the Virgin Mary in a lot of ways, but it's designed, that's design, purpose of that, again, is to bring you to more and more chastity, of behavior, attitude, thoughts, mind, okay? Pure habits, austerity. So that's very great. So if you see the Virgin Mary in that way, then that's wonderful. I'm all for it. But it's turned into a veneration cult. It's not for the purpose of veneration. So Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was very adamant about this. She says, I'm nobody's guru. You know, she avoided that sort of veneration. She was there. She came to help purify our habits. And of course, people, what they do is they try to make a deal with her. And this is the same thing with the Virgin Mary, which is, look, I'll venerate and worship you if I could just keep some of these bad habits I have. And Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma said, no deals, folks, here. Sorry, can't make that deal. So she was just adamantly strict, and never could you ever make such a deal with her. So she's like the ideal goddess. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma is the ideal, she's the perfect ideal of the goddess who uses all these skillful means of grace to help us with evaporate our bad habits. But she doesn't get too much into the skillful teaching. She touches upon it, but her goal is to get to these habits, because if you don't get the habits right, you're not going to get to the already there practice. So she didn't emphasize that so much, but it was there a bit, you know, here and there. But she said, hey, look, you'll get to that, but first you have to clean your life up. So the Catholic Church has it right in terms of Jesus represents guru vision, which is where it's at. It's not our habits that's the ultimate goal. It's not our chastity is the ultimate goal. The ultimate goal is guru vision, is a vision of inherent spaciousness and abiding in that. That's the goal. But to get to that, you need to have purify your life. But we cannot, again, fall into the trap of trying to make deals with the Virgin Mary. Okay, this is what has happened. It's the people have turned her into a mother. And of course, every child feels that the mother will be indulgent of them. And this is a problem. So Sri Sri Anandamayi always insisted that we do not relate to her as mother. I'm not here as a mother archetype, she said. Please view me as a friend, primarily as a friend. And if you want to see me as part of your family, which is fine, if you're a real family person, see me as your little daughter. Okay? That's very simple. See me as your friend or as your little daughter. But do not see me as a mother. Those who see her as a mother are trying to make a deal with her. Okay, trying to make a deal with their habits. But you can see that, you know, again, the child wants, oh, the mother will take care of everything. I can be a little naughty and mischievous in this way. I can be lazy in this way. It's okay. She'll say, that's okay, child. You know, it's okay. That's not it. That's not it. That's the crucial mistake that we've made throughout history. We can never get into the mother archetype, okay? Never get into that. I avoided that. I saw Sri Sri Anandamayi as a friend. And I took her advice to heart. I heard it very clearly. She says, wow. Okay, let's avoid the mother thing. Yeah, no kidding. Virgin Mary, same thing. To take this archetype as a friend, as a sister. She also said, view me as your sister. If it's either a friend or a little daughter or your sister, if you want to put it as a family thing. I'm not so much into family, so I take her as a friend. An uncompromising friend. But we try to cajole her and we say, oh, Ma, you're so great, oh, you're so great. What we're really saying is, you know, I already think you're so great, you know, so you don't need to be so strict, you know. If you're strict, I might not think you're so great, right? It's this clever deal. Is I praise you, praise you, praise you, praise you, praise you, but I'll stop praising you if you get too strict with me, you know, that kind of thing, right? So it's trying to get over on her. She doesn't fall for this. She didn't fall for this, so. So then the guys come in, you know, Manjushri, Buddha, Longchenpa, and they're the ones who are very skillful at practice. Say, practice this way. I want you to practice this way. Practice. Be a spiritual athlete. Come on, you know, more time. Practice like this. Intense practice. And so that's the other side of it. That's essential. Good habits without intense practice are wasted, and you'll fall back. So yeah, you need the good habits to get to the practice, but if you don't actually do the practice, which is essential, then you won't succeed. So you can't just say, Ma, you're so great, I love you so much, and not practice. You know, that's laziness. It's indulgence. Say, Mother, please indulge your little child. I'm lazy. That's not it, is it? So I'm here on a Saturday morning, you know, after intense, super intense yesterday. Getting up first thing, back into the super intensity of this, right? So you need a combination. But it's very important to have the so-called masculine male archetype as preeminent, because otherwise we'll fall into this deal ideology of idolizing the mother, the Virgin Mary, the goddess, idolizing her, hoping that she'll be indulgent with us. And we tend to default to that because of our relationship with our mother. An experience we have, everyone has, born of a mother, is we feel that they're supposed to take care of us. And they're obligated to take care of us. And so we get tricky with it, you know? We fool ourselves. Whereas the dad is more demanding of us, right? Tends to be. When we think we've tricked the mother into being indulgent, the father comes home and says, "Hey, I told you to do your homework." "No, but mom told me." You know, you get that, right? This is the key dynamic that we have to face here. Father comes home and says, "Where's your homework? Where's your project? You haven't finished?" No, but mom said I could, you know, gave me more time. Mom said, because the child has charmed the mother, right? Children are very, very, very clever at this. We're very clever of how to charm the mother and get a delay from her. And then the father says, "I don't care." You know, he has to say, "Look, I don't care what your mom said. You charmed her somehow. You've got to get this project done. You got to get it done tonight. You know, don't go to bed until it's finished. You know, no dinner for you until it's finished." The child starts crying. "So mean. The dad's so mean." You know, so we look at the dad as so mean. The male energy or aspect is so mean. You know, I want more time to do it. But this is a. This is what's wrong with the world. The world has become way, way over effeminate, thinking that it can charm the mother. This is the problem. We've stalled out. We've stalled out as a planet. We're not tough enough anymore. We can't handle the toughness of the father coming in. Father's tough. He says, "Hey, you know what? Your house is burning down, and you're talking about delay. You said you charmed your mother, saying, I can stay in my room a little longer. That your room's on fire. What are you talking about? Get out of your room right now, this instant." See, that's the male energy, and that's essential. And what we've done in the world is we've demonized the male energy, the archetype. The masculine archetype, the father archetype. We've demonized it. We've subverted it. We've termited it. We've turned the world through this junk entertainment and junk culture. Because we're all lazy. We want to indulge ourselves. We say, "Don't." We've charmed the mother. You know, she'll be indulgent of us. Well, guess what? Despair is not indulgent of us at all. The design of this existence is despair. So as you're delaying in despair. So your house is on fire. With the fire of despair. You got to get out of that house. You have to get out right now. You cannot be indulgent. So we're so used to being able to charm our way. "Hey, mom, look what I did." And tears, you know. And mom says, "Oh, the baby. I don't want to hurt the poor baby. I got to be careful with the feelings of the baby." And the father comes home and says, "Look, you're old enough to get this done now. No more crying, no more tears. Get it done. Get it done now." That's what we need, you see. That's what we're lacking in the world. This is what is precious and valuable now. It's all the more precious because we're lacking it so severely. This is what we're lacking. Is the man coming on the scene and saying, "Hey, I don't want to hear any excuses. Okay? Don't give me any talk at all. Be quiet. I don't want excuses. The time for excuses is over." time for excuses is over. You have to get it done right now. No excuses. I don't care about your tears. They don't get to me. They might work on your mom. They don't work with me. So we think that our tears are working on the Virgin Mary or the goddess, and that she will then go convey our tears to God. This is not true. This is a lie. The tears don't get to God at all. They don't get to the Virgin Mary either, actually. The true goddess is not fooled for what one bit. They know, you know, that archetype is the grace, that's a aspect of grace working for us. You need both aspects. What's missing in the world is the male aspect, the God aspect. This is what is missing of grace, that adamant, demanding, adamant, no excuse. Yeah, you feel terrible. Yeah, God, this morning I felt terrible. What I do? Bob, I feel terrible. And I turned to the Father. I said, the Father aspect of grace, the guy friend of grace, you know, great Manjushri, friend of mine, some male aspect. And I said, Manjushri, what should I do? And Manjushri says, well, did you stretch this morning? I said, no. Did you stretch last night like I've told you to? I said, I forgot. I said, well, start stretching then. Your body's all tight, it's all tired. You didn't stretch last night like I told you to. You know, why you got such bad habits? Yeah. He doesn't listen to my excuses. He says, don't make excuses. It's the shock of success is tiring you out. You're making great breakthroughs for me. Thank you very much, but you got to take care of yourself. You got to stretch. You've got, you know, get your body, you know, limber, more limber. I mean, come on. Stop making excuses. Get with it. I'm like, wow, thank you. Thank you so much. Now, I'll tell you, in this world, when you can come to the point where you thank God for the adamacy, the grace of God, for that adamant aspect, that tough love aspect, that can really most effectively come from the male aspect. It doesn't come as effectively from the female aspect at all, and it will never do so. And this is just a fact. Just as working with habits in a way, the mother is able to work in that way better, okay? So there's some that the grace of God working in a female way and a male way is better this way, it's better that way, and this way is better that way. This is just a fact. And what has happened in this world is a catastrophe. I came across, well, let it settle in. It's a catastrophe. We don't have enough of the male energy, the male adamacy at all in the world. It's almost, you know, it's like in danger of vanishing, actually, disappearing. Feminism, radical feminism, said, look, we can do it all. We don't even need the male aspect of grace. What they really mean is, we're afraid of that. We're lazy. We're undisciplined. We're lazy. And we think we can charm the goddess into saying, that's okay, don't worry. Well, what happens is then, what they're really saying is, we think despair will work. That's exactly what they're saying. The feminists, radical feminists, are saying, we believe that despair will work. So we'll take you there. We know how to get you there. Well, yeah, they do. They most certainly do. And they're taking us there. And their goal was then to get rid of this male aspect, which would say, hey, wait a minute. I'm not putting up with excuses. No, despair doesn't work. It will never work. You got to get down to business and get working here. Excuses don't work. Okay? So I want you to start practicing right now. You got no choice. You got no choice. They're trying to get rid of that male voice. They've tried to silence the male voice in the world, and they've pretty much done so. The male voices here in these videos, very few people watch them, okay? They say, no, we don't need that for our goals. That's not, well, the goal of radical feminism, is despair. They think that despair is transformative. It will modify us. It won't. 100% sure it will not. I know this directly from experience, direct experience. We can never modify what we are. So it's futile, complete path of futility is all that it is. So recognize the difference here and stop trying to homogenize it. which is just a way of trying to avoid it, right? So you could have some of this and some of that, but recognize the difference. We're working on habits, breaking habits. Okay, that takes some time. Full stop in the wild. Be patient. That's great. And then let's get back to practice. No excuses here. No excuses. Your house is on fire. Get out of the house right now. You're already there. What do you mean I got to work on my habits? You're already there. In other words, right? So to get to this already there-ness, it's very adamant. There's no excuses at all. So, we need both in the world, and the balance has to be proper. It's completely out of balance now, as far as the feminine dominating to an extreme extent. And you see where in certain situations where it's not so out of whack, they're making way more progress. Like Tibetan Buddhism has a much better balance of that. They understand the balance of it, and they've kept it for a long time. And the feminists are, of course, trying to destroy Tibetan Buddhism. They actually are. And Tibetan Buddhists are kind of aware of that. It's like, these lawsuits, these harassment things, you're sexist, you need... And they're even gone so far as to pressure the Dalai Lama into saying Dalai Lama apparently said, I don't know if he said this or not, the feminists say he did, that he said that his next incarnation of Dalai Lama may very well be as a woman. And it's like, if that isn't an indication of how totally out of whack this world is at this point, I don't know what is. What they're really saying is, we believe that despair will work, and we can be a separate from God. We can separate from God because we can change what we are. We can modify what we are, which means we're not part of God anymore, and we'll be a separate creator. That's what they're really saying. I mean, that's just so crazy. That's like coming to the Virgin Mary and say, hey, or Sri Sri Nandamayama, say, hey, Sri Sri Nandamayama, in your next incarnation, you should probably incarnate as a man. That'd probably be better for us. What an insult. What stupidity, okay? What utter stupidity. She's perfect at doing what she needs to do, which is a super important aspect of grace, okay? And the Dalai Lama is doing a great job at what he needs to do, which is the male aspect of grace, being very adamant and very decisive and very, the way, hey, drugs are poison. I mean, he says the tough stuff that needs to be said. He says the tough stuff. At least he is most of his life, right? I mean, so why in the world would you try to, subvert that? That is ridiculous. No, reincarnate as a man. We need more men, adamant male teachers in this world, not less. This is the problem we have. We have almost none anymore. It's completely out of balance. So to suggest that Dalai Lama should return as a woman is so utterly ridiculous. It just shows you how far this world has fallen to even take that seriously. And then someone replied, well, what's the big deal? Well, I'm just telling you what the big deal is. It's an extremely big deal. So we have subverted our success in this world and turned towards despair by, basically eliminating the other side of the equation, which is this adamancy that demands that we practice. And that's always the danger in this world, is to go back to the goddess, worshiping the goddess, always. The goddess has always been there. The idea of the feminists say that it's been out of balance and all that stuff is nonsense. Okay? We always have this relationship with the mother there, every single one of us, and we always default back to that when we struggle with the adamant male side. Okay, saying, no, you must reach this goal. You can, you will, you must. You have no choice. Despair doesn't work. We go, oh, no, it seems so difficult. Continuity fear. Oh, I'm scared, mom. And go running back to mom. Always. So we're never in danger of getting rid of the feminine aspect of grace. We're in no danger of that whatsoever. We never are in danger of that. The danger is getting rid of the male aspect of grace, and we're always in danger of that. This is what we have to guard against. So if you err, you must err on the side of caution. And this is where the feminists got into us, is they said, hey, you know, it's too much emphasis on the male. You have to err on the side of caution, because the continuity fear always has us retreat back towards the feminine and the goddess and all that, okay, the mother, always. And so you must avoid that by full stopping the wow. This is what the male aspect helps us, okay. And ultimately, we transcend both of these, okay. We're transcending both of these. Inherent spaciousness is neither male nor female. So it's a means to an end. So we have to err on the side of caution here. Have to. It's the way the dynamic is. There's no escaping it. The feminists are simply not seeing the dynamic at all. Oblivious to it. Because their goal is not liberation. Their goal is despair. They believe liberation through despair is the answer. And in fact, you do not get liberated through despair. You only reach this total mental chaos, black hole, and nothing happens except you say, it doesn't work. And then what do? Then you've got to turn around and walk back that road that you walked down. So you never get this type of talk from the female energy at all. You never get this type of talk. Not the emphasis like this. This is the male job, you see. And this is what's lacking in the world. The capacity to be this way. To talk like this. You know, straight, direct, honest, admonishing, tough love talk is, again, virtually extinct in this world, which means the world is headed for a catastrophe. And the Dalai Lama is 81 years old, and he's the symbol of male spirituality in the world. Okay, and Tibetans do tend not to be too long-lived, actually. They're not like these centenarians. You don't see many Tibetans that live to be 100 years. It's not like that. So 81 is old. It's old. And a lot of the tough Tibetan teachers, the great male teachers, the great lamas, a lot of them have passed on. You know, they understood the balance. They didn't cede their authority to the goddess. They said, look, goddess has her domain of expertise. We have our domain of expertise. The two work together to help us transcend the entire situation. And we're not ceding our realm of expertise at all. That would be crazy. That would be to fail the Dharma. And now, with a lot of those older Tibetan lamas, Rinpoches, dying, passing over, what are we left with? Yeah, we're left with a generation that have been, you know, viciously attacked by the feminists. And demand. No, No, they're not. Again, you have to err on the side of caution. It's not really an err at all. You have to make sure you keep this male emphasis front and center in your life. Otherwise, you will just default back into trying to charm the mother. And you'll stall out. You'll stall out. You always have this feminine in your life. What's the difficult part is to have the adamant male perspective in your life. That's what everybody is failing right now. The younger people just don't have it. A lot, most of them. They just don't have it at all. It's mind-blowing how bad the situation is. They expect you to be a mother to them. Some cultures, like African American culture, they hardly have a male presence at all in their lives growing up. So all they hear is mother, 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 mother. They want the government to be their mother. They want their government to be the mother, which is why they're so afraid of Trump, for instance. Sorry to bring politics into it, but all politics is spiritual. He has more male energy. You know, says, hey, no excuses. No excuses here. This is what needs to be done. This is what we have to do. No, stop making excuses. I want it done now. That's you know, more the male, that's male energy. And they're all like, you know, in their cribs, freaking out, crying, having a conniption fit, a tantrum. You know, they can't handle that energy at all. For me, it doesn't bother me in the slightest bit. And as a matter of fact, I would handle Trump. I'd be the more adamant than him. If I was playing golf, I said, "Hey, you know, Donald, don't give me any of that. You know, no, stop making excuses here. You know, and I'd give him that piece of my mind. You know, so I'm not intimidated or bothered by him at all." It doesn't mean I agree with his policies one way or another, but the energy, the male energy, doesn't scare me at all. I'm tougher than that, way tougher. But most people, not most, some are saying, "Hey, we still need that male energy, folks," you know. And the others are saying, "Oh no, that's going to cause a nuclear war." They've always say that, you know. No, it won't. It'll deter it. It'll deter it. Ronald Reagan deterred the Cold War, deterred a nuclear war. It's the female energy, too much of that imbalance, that leads to nuclear wars, or worse, actually, or worse, which is global tyranny. Big Mother leads to Big Mother. That's the last thing you want. It's the worst outcome of all, is the New World Order Big Mother bureaucracy. That's the worst outcome, which is intended to eliminate this male adamancy entirely, which paves the way for total despair, which they believe paves the way for us to be our own God, separate from God, which is comes from arrogance, spiritual arrogance. And this is what Jesus came to free us from, came to free us from Big Mother. Okay, Jesus came to free us from Big Mother. The Virgin Mary is not Big Mother. If you turn her into Big Mother, she's not the Virgin Mary anymore. You're worshiping an idol. She's not a fertility goddess, folks. Okay, that's not the Virgin Mary. She spiritually brings you to spiritual chastity, renunciation, renunciation. Go into the monasteries, so to speak. Go into your own monastery in your life. Go towards that of austerity, chastity, brahmacharya. She's not a fertility goddess at all. So, men and women, we're supposed to be able to both succeed, because as a man, I can get this female help with all my habits and chastity and all this, and welcome all that, which I did, into my life. And at the same time, I take all the Manjushri, Buddha, Longchenpa, Jesus, all that, Ramaharshi, take that into my life and get this adamant practice and determination, no excuses, and use it both to succeed. The women should do the same thing. They should identify with the female aspects of their habits and purify their lives, and at the same time welcome in the male energy and get this adamant determination, focus, no excuses. You know, yeah, I'm tired, but so what? You know, I got no excuse. I have to succeed. My house is burning down. I got no choice. I got to make a super effort here. And I don't, no whining, no whining, no whining, no, to the whiny child, no. Go to your room and get it done. I don't want to hear a peep out of you until you've got it done. No food, nothing. Tough love, you know. No tears. I don't care. I don't care about your tears. You know, you got to do this. Both. We both can have both. And then we transcend both in abidance, in vision of intrinsic spaciousness, guru vision, which is the already here-ness, total already here-ness. Without any establishment of it, without a trace of ever being established, without a trace of ever using skillful means to get what it, to be what it is, traceless in its already here-ness, traceless in its already here-ness. So we have a disaster brewing in the world, spiritual disaster. I'm raising my voice as much as I can. Very few are listening. I really appreciate the ones who do listen. Yeah, you're not only helping me, you're helping everyone. And I know the Dharma Kings are aware of this and very appreciative of it. Extremely appreciative of it. Because all we got to get back to the right balance eventually. There's no other way. Well, there's no other way. So we might as well do it now. There's waiting doesn't help at all. It just caused us to spiral into despair. This is the truth. There's no use in sugarcoating the truth. Yeah, this just creates bad habits in us, very bad habits. So we've gotten into terrible bad habits in the world. Too much sugarcoating, too much icing on the cake. And we've taken the icing to be the cake. It's too much icing on the cake. No, the icing is just to attract us to the cake. The cake is the cake of vision of intrinsic spaciousness, guru vision. All right. Paradoxically, it's when we realize we can't shift into it that we experience it, because it means we're already there. We don't need a dream to shift into reality, do we? It's like, when will you get it? What must I do? You must seek and find the truth. Oh, when will I get it? When you stop seeking and to find the truth. It's like this. And we keep asking for clarifications, but it's our bad habits that are holding us back. It's our lack of practicing that's holding us back. The practice is here, full stop, and the wow is the practice. As soon as we commit to this, the clarity will spontaneously arise in us. Spontaneously. It's already there. There's nothing to grasp. What is there to grasp in intrinsic spaciousness? There's no aspect to it. There's no parts to it. There's nothing to grasp. So it's already ungraspable. We don't need to smooth it out. It's already smooth. So there's no work we need to do on intrinsic spaciousness. So when we finally accept that there's nothing we need to do, then we'll be aware of it. We'll accept it as it is. The other efforts is the belief that somehow we have to do something. But when we realize that we don't have to do anything, then we'll realize, oh, well, I'm already there. Okay. It's like that. How are we doing on this? Oh my gosh, it's a long one. Sorry. But I'm on a roll. It's just been effortless, kind of, here. Now, because it's so out of balance now, the grace, the energies of our acceptance. We've basically said we'll only accept female grace. We won't accept any male, masculine type of grace anymore at all. This then causes this catastrophic imbalance, which defaults back towards despair and materialism. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. There's no question about it. So, feminists are just, radical feminists, they're just flat out mistaken. That's all there is to it. There's nothing more to be said about it. They're subversives. They're spiritual subversives, actually. Okay. Now, if you've been through that, you can see it as a phase. Okay. That's actually a phase, a rebellious phase, coming from your continuity fear. So, you don't condemn yourself for going through a phase, but you get out as fast as possible. And we say, wow, it was just, I wanted to indulge myself and in this world a little more. And now I realize the price that I pay is going to be like severe mental psychosis. No, I think I want to avoid the worst of that. So let's get out of that phase. Let's welcome back the adamant male grace. Okay, let's welcome that back. Let's start getting familiar with it again. It's just like the crazy wisdom phase. You get through with it and you're done with it. You say, enough of that. Okay. I'm not interested in that anymore. I'm welcoming back, you know, the purity. I welcome it back. And it's an old friend. Wow. I thought I could be happy without my old friend, but you know what? I realize now I cannot be happy with it. And so we welcome back the male energy, the male clarity, the male severity, the male toughness, right? We welcome it back with open arms as a friend. Say, oh, wow, so great that you're back, you know? It feels so good to hear that adamant voice. It feels so good to hear that. God, what was I thinking? Well, continuity fear was dancing with me. Was dancing me. And when it dances you without recognizing it, it goes towards despair. When you recognize it and say, aha, gotcha, I know what you are now. I know the right practice, full stop in the wow. Then suddenly you're finished with that phase. You're done with it. So feminism, radical feminism, will simply, you'll realize you're done with it. Because it was only continuity fear dancing with you, not realizing that it was continuity fear. As soon as you realize that it was just continuity fear. Same with crazy wisdom. As soon as you see it's continuity fear. Oh, wow. Okay, now it's the only problem I have is continuity fear. All I have to do is work on evaporating it. I need right practice to evaporate it. Welcome back, tough love. Welcome back, no excuses. Welcome back, practicing. Ah. Oh. That's wonderful. Instead of being depraved and trying to excuse it through all sorts of clever, hey, I'm super spiritually hip lingo and blah, blah, blah. Now I got no excuse. Now I'm actually back to practicing. Really practicing. And not hanging out with those crazy wisdom adepts. Not hanging out with that stuff. Okay? I'm not hanging out with it anymore. I'm done with it. And I'm welcoming back the purity and the chastity and the adamancy of now. And practice. Feels great to be able to recognize and full stop in the wow and recognize the success. It feels great to succeed. It feels great to have a smooth path. It feels great to get up in the morning and not make excuses, doesn't it? Sure it does. It feels awesome. Now, I know why I feel so tired and wiped out, because what I'm doing now is breaking the ice, you know, for everyone. And you know, walking into Home Depot backwards and taping this and then putting it on the internet, it may seem like an easy thing to do, but it is not. The stuff that I'm doing, singing in public like this and taping the way I'm doing, this is nerve-wracking. Because I'm going counter the conventions of the day. You know, as someone who has the right balance of the male and female grace, and erring on the side of caution, meaning having to emphasize the male aspect of it for sure, because that's what we're most leery of, okay. You know, I'm persona non grata in the world. And so people are not going to be indulgent of what I do, you know. So I really have to be I have to have Manjushri produce my videos, which is an amazing experience I had yesterday. Suddenly, I've been calling Manjushri into my life, and I suddenly got this idea, like, why don't I let Manjushri produce the videos now, to put it in his hands? I said, yeah. And immediately I got a confirmation that's what is needed. And so I tried it out, best video I've ever made. And it's necessary. Otherwise, these videos wouldn't get made. It's too difficult. It's way too difficult because the world is not friendly to it at all. It wants to eradicate this aspect of grace, which is, again, saying that, hey, we want to be separate from God. God, we don't need you in that way. We're going to modify what grace, how grace speaks to us. Yeah, you gave us your grace, but we're going to modify it now. Let's go just with the feminine side of it. Again, isn't that arrogance and modifying God? Of course it is. God gave us this 360-degree grace of the Holy Spirit. He didn't give us partial grace. He gave us 360-degree grace. And I use the term he. It's very important to use the term he for God. Because, again, this is what we shrink away from, back to the she. Okay? So we have to err on the side of caution. This is crucial. So this is not negotiable. This is not negotiable. We use the term he for God. Okay? We use the term Father, he. Jesus set us this example. And I now understand the wisdom of this example. If we stop doing that, we're going to start sliding back into, hey, let's modify grace. And then we'll default back to the feminine mother. And we'll have big mother bureaucracy, new world order, which is exactly where we're headed. Proof's in the pudding, isn't it? So he, God, he, Father. Okay? Get used to it. You'll like it. Welcome back to No Excuses. So I get up in the morning, I'm exhausted, I'm tired, and it's because I'm doing stuff you just don't see people do. You know, I'm stopping by the side of the road, I pull up, I get out, I see something, I walk back, cars are whizzing past me, I'm taping, I'm walking while I'm taping, I'm using a selfie stick, I stop, I'm taping this, someone's house, you know, I'm doing this yard, or whatever, and people are saying, what is he doing? I was taping one of the videos that I taped, what was the name of that? I forget the name, because the names aren't important of the video. The one... I could look it up. Anyway, I was taping this, the one just before this entrance of grace. And where I'm sitting on a rock over a lake, and then I'm walking down that concrete, spillway. Well, when I was taping that, I got to this real steep area of the spillway where it just drops off so severely. And I said, man, if I try to go any further, I'll slip and fall and I'll be killed. You know, it's dangerous. And then I went back to this area. I was going to tape myself on the edge of this. Like in some dramatic, heroic, pose of, I'm right on the edge of danger. So I was setting up my camera for it. And suddenly this guy just appeared. He had come down the walkway, down the wall, and walked all the way down. I didn't hear him. So I looked, and there's this guy right standing next to me, and he's smiling at me. He says, hey, how's it going? I said, wow, how are you doing? He says, well, looks, are you skating? What are you doing? You just going to skate this or what? And then he starts talking, and we start talking about how steep it is. He said, no, I just wanted to see what you're doing. It looked really interesting. And then later his friend comes down, too. There are two of them there. And we're talking about how steep this spillway is. And how I said, would you go down there? They say, no way, no way, no way. No. Too dangerous. And then I was thinking, and I start walking down it, and they look at me and say, are you kidding me? And I say, maybe Monday, if like we're in really good shape with the right shoes and everything, maybe. But these some young men telling me this, like, hey. So the Holy Spirit sent them to say, hey, look, you got to be aware there's a fine line here, okay? Don't try to be too heroic here just to enhance the production value of a video by doing something too dangerous, okay? Okay, that's that. You got to know where to draw the line. And so they were sent there to just these young men saying, look, if we don't do it, probably it's a good idea for you not to do it also, right? And so I was humble enough to say, yeah, okay. I didn't show off for him. I said, no, not right now. So they really helped me out a lot. So as we try to get this thing back, like, hey, don't be scared. Yeah, but also don't be stupid. So I walked across the reservoir face, which was kind of steep, but I tested it out very carefully. I realized I'm not going to fall. I got to be very careful, but I'm not going to fall. And that's a male kind of thing, right? So we're on the edge of toughness, but not too tough. We're not stupid tough, okay? So we're tough, but not stupid tough. This is the purpose of it, right? Yeah, we push ourselves. I push myself constantly. I always feel tired and the stress of it. The stress of taping out in public is very intense. You just don't see other people doing it at this point. I mean, some people got their smartphones, but they're kind of walking along and there's like a selfie like that, or a little bit like that. But you don't see someone, very rarely see someone actually doing a production and shots just spontaneously in public, you know. I've never seen people do this. There's only been a few times where that was happening. I remember back when camcorders came out, this little Sony camcorders that were, you know, they were still tape, but they had the portable battery, small. They were small, and everybody got them. And for a while, everybody was taping where they went, and then it just went away. And I kept doing it. I was like the only one that kept doing it. And people were like, "What are you still doing? That fad's gone." Same thing with selfie sticks now. People look at me like, "What are you using a selfie stick for? That was just a fad. It's finished." Not for me, it's actually very helpful. So you look like you're out of, you know, out of fashion. You're behind times. You're not really with it. That's odd. What are you doing that for? So people kind of say, "That's odd. What are they doing?" You know. So and you get this pressure, you know. So it's you have to be very, very intrepid. So these videos, you know, people don't realize how difficult they are to make, actually. That's why you don't see them like this. You just don't see it. You have to be very aware not to push. You push the limits, but not too much. And very polite and very pure and accommodate and have the right attitude. And people, so people will say, "You're okay. Okay, no worries." Because people are uptight. They're very uptight right now. They're all out of balance. They say, "We need more. We need more to spare. We need more Big Mother. We need everything regulated. We need our breaths regulated." You know. I mean, it's just they're in this insanity, basically. People are headed towards a severe psychosis. So, I'm dealing with psychotic people, and that's tough. It's tough. I understand that. I have to be very positive, very super positive, and full of grace. And really trust in the grace of of God to engineer stuff, to arrange stuff so that I'm able to dig the videos and the wrong people don't come along, you know, and throw a bummer on it, the whole thing. And you know, it just has to flow in the right way. And it just takes tremendous trust to do it, you know, because if I don't, I can't do it. I'm too scared. You can't just be spontaneous in public and tape it and do this stuff anymore in this world. You know, people just they'll say, "Why? You're crazy. You must be psychotic." In other words, they project their own psychosis onto me. That's the danger. That's the danger. So, yeah, it's nerve-wracking, but also exhilarating. And so I got to finish this one up now. It's easy doing these videos compared to going out and taping. I mean, that's. It takes tremendous trust, and if you start messing up, you got to catch it quick and say, "Okay, let's not do that. Let's back off of this. You're not ready for that. Let's not try to do too much. You know, just enough is right." And trust it, trust it, trust it, trust it, trust it. So, you know, pray for my success here because these videos are so unique. They give this unique flavor. That you say, "Hey, wait a minute, how come I can't do that?" Well, too much mother is why. Too much goddess. Don't blame the goddess. The goddess of grace. She's not the one asking you to give too much attention to her or worship her. Not at all. She's trying to get you back to, "Hey, you need the male aspect too. Come on, get with that. Why are you overlooking that? It's disaster for you." So Sri Srinanda, my mom would say, "Mom, we want to worship you." And she says, "Who's your guru?" "Well, this guy." She says, "You pay attention to him. Okay, just do a better job of it. Practice more. Listen to the." So she was very aware of the male capacity to practice, you know, drill sergeant, you know, boot camp, drill sergeant. You know what? They prevent you from being killed in war, don't they? You look back and say, "Wow, it's the best thing that ever happened to me. The drill sergeant was so tough on me, but he toughened me up. He toughened me up. And I needed that. I was such a wuss. I was so lazy, so indulgent. My mom indulged me so much. And I get this guy screaming at me, 'You got to do this, God, no excuses.' And it's like, wow." But looking back, you know, You say, like, wow, I'm an officer and a gentleman now. You know, it was the best thing that ever happened to me in my life. Spiritual boot camp is what everybody needs, actually. They'll get it at some point. Better to get it right now. Better to get it right now before you go into a full-blown psychosis, which is, believe me, that you wouldn't wish that on anyone. You don't wish a full-blown psychosis on anyone for any reason. Your worst enemy, you would not wish that upon them. You would say, no, 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 no. They're not that bad. So you do not want a full-blown psychosis. And the world is headed free falling into full-blown psychosis. So watch these videos. Don't worry about what's the message, what's this. It's what you put into it, okay? Yeah, I edit them in a certain way to to suggest and invoke a possible interpretation. But if you don't have that interpretation, fine. It's what how you play the piano is how you hear the music, you know? So I'm not dogmatic in that way. So I have a balance that's helpful. I'm not dogmatic. There's no one way that's supposed to be interpreted, and if you don't get it, then you're, you know, that's bad, you failed. No. Because the goal is familiarity. So the very fact that you're watching it is you're getting familiar with it, okay? Our goal is familiarity, not some dogmatic right interpretation of what's the message. I remember when you were in school, you were reading, you know, Hermann Hesse and Faulkner and, what was it? Melville and Dante and Shakespeare and, you know, Shelley, the poets, and Yeats and Keats and, you know, Thoreau and whatever, you know, and the classics, Cervantes and you know, on and on and on and on and on, right? The great books, the great works, the classical education, okay, I had that. And you're tested on how well you interpret, how accurately you interpret what their message was. What was their message to you? What was the purpose? And you're supposed to be able to read the book according to what the author wanted you to get. And I remember I always hated that so much. I hated my education. I say, this is ruinous. This is not a spiritual education. This is a dogmatic education. Okay? So we don't have dogma like that here in these videos, in what the material we give. You know what? Because familiarity is our goal. Ease and familiarity and say, ah, this is my friend. I welcome this into my life as a friend. We already have the one practice, the practice. We know the goal. We know the skillful means. We have the Holy Grail. We drink from the Holy Grail. Okay, that is what it is. But in terms of this media content and this artistic stuff and all this, don't feel like, oh, I'm not really sure what you meant by that. No, because I'm just doing it all spontaneous anyway. I don't even know where it's going. It's just happening. And there's all sorts of depth to it. There's lots of different ways you can interpret whatever is most useful, really. But the bigger thing is that it's there. It's a miracle it's there. It's even there. Like, how did it even get here? How did this video happen? What is this? I mean, that video I made last night, Entrance of Grace, blew my mind. I said, how did this happen? I never could even conceive this ahead of time. How could this happen? This is amazing. Wow. Grace of God, Manjushri, Buddha, Longchenpa, Jamyang Khyentse Lodro, Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, Vajra, Yogini Vajra, Vahari, Virgin Mary, all of that. The grace of God made it happen. The grace of God made it happen. I'm just an instrument, you know, that's being played. I'm the piano that's being played. So you hear the music. Does the piano create the music, or does the player? Well, the player is pretty much responsible, right? So I just, you know, point the camera, record, and then upload, and then edit, and put together and make sure it's kind of smooth and post it up there. And, you know, I do that. I do all that kind of work. But the inspiration somehow it's the grace of God that's making it happen. So you're just getting familiar with the grace of God in a more potent way, in a more balanced, potent way, is what you're getting used to. That's what's important. That's what's important. You're getting used to it in a more potent and balanced way, the grace of God. Now, I friend on Facebook the yoga girls, the feminists. There's one that I didn't. She's a real hard case. I said, not right now, maybe later. I don't know what I'm going to do with that one. But I'm aware that these are yoga girls. These are positive, this and this. And that. But, maybe they need, maybe they're calling out saying, help, I'm stuck. This is too much feminism. It's I got to get out of this. How do I get out of this? I'm stuck. So I shouldn't say no to them, because maybe they're going to get some flavor of that. And then at some point they'll realize, hey, it was just continuity fear. This whole trip I was on was just continuity fear. It was in control of me. But now I see that what it is, I'm in control of it now because I can evaporate it. I'm in control. Oh, I don't need that stuff anymore. Welcome back, the male energy. Thank God. The balanced energy, welcome back. And let's err on the side of caution now, having been burned so badly. Wow. Let's start being really chaste now. No more of this yoga girl chic stuff, the degenerate, crazy wisdom yoga girl stuff. I've had enough of that. Finished with it. Hopefully, I hope the grace of God is sending them to me for that reason. Because I don't know how else they're going to get out of it unless start realizing, oh, wait a minute, it's not so bad. And, yeah. I think I don't want to go into psychosis, full-blown psychosis. Some of them are very close. Some of the yoga girls are going into full-blown psychosis right now, actually. And depravity, very bad depravity. They're tipping over right now. I've seen the comments that they say, hey, why don't we just, get freaky? Why don't we just celebrate our freakiness? But they're using freakiness in a different way, It's the unbalanced freakiness. What I am is not a freak, but a super freak. Okay, it's very different. A grace-filled super freak. Whereas the other is an imbalanced ego freakiness. Freakiness is not a freak. Okay, that's different. The freak has it all in perspective. Freaking out is what they're talking about. They say, let's freak out. Let's get freaky means let's freak out. Let's get out of real freakiness and go into this imbalanced, egoic, despair-based freakiness. So they're saying, let's freak out. Seriously, they're saying that. Says, you know what? I think it's time we just freak out. And whatever feels good, whatever we want to do, let's just indulge in it. That's the way. No, that's the way to despair. That's the way to despair. So they're right at the edge of that, So I don't want to get pulled into that. I'm thinking I shouldn't turn down those requests, I don't want to, have them nagging me, trying to pull me down, but I don't have to pay attention to it, I'm for everyone's salvation. They're just out of balance right now, and they're leading to a catastrophe, so they have to be admonished. Male energy admonishes, It's able to admonish and say, look, this is what you're doing is leading to ruination. You need to stop it. You need to stop it right now. Stop being so indulgent of that. Understand its continuity fear is having its way with you. It's dancing you. You're not dancing it. It's dancing you. You got to be in charge of the dance, not your continuity fear. And when you're in charge and realize that, you stop being so crazy. You stop being, you stop freaking out. I don't freak out. I do stuff that people think, oh, this is a freak. What is that guy's freaky? But no, I'm not freaking out. I'm calm. I'm socially adjusted. I get along with people beautifully. I smile. I converse with them. They realize, oh, he's not freaked out at all. So it's okay. They realize, oh, this somebody's not freaked out. He's with it. He's really with it. He's just sort of super hip or something. So people don't get alarmed by me. really, when I'm doing this taping and doing this stuff. They don't get alarmed. They can tell I'm a professional. I know what I'm doing, and he knows his business. He's minding his own business well. He's not going to bother me. He'll let me mind my own business. It's like that. But I really have to be spot on, and I have to be in great shape to do this because you're out of my comfort zone. You feel tired. You feel weak. It's amazing. I could hardly get up on that rock in that video to sit on that rock. I should be able to jump up there. And it's like, oh, I can barely do it because I'm out of my comfort zone. When you get out of your comfort zone, you feel weak because you're ambivalent. Your ambivalence enters into your mind and your body doesn't know what to do. You're not sure because you're not telling, giving mixed messages to your body. Then the body feels like weak and tired. But I said, wait a minute, that's ridiculous. I can run upstairs, I can jump upstairs, but this is what happens. So it's physically taxing, very much so, mentally taxing. Mentally taxing. But by all means, take advantage of the opportunity here. Take advantage of the opportunity. This doesn't come around very often, especially now. So we'll keep the balance about.